In the 1930s, an area of land near Tholthorpe, 2 miles west of Easingwold in North Yorkshire, was surveyed as a suitable location for a satellite airfield for nearby RAF Linton-on-Ouse. Construction of the airfield began in 1939. On the 28th of August 1940, RAF Tholthorpe, then a grass-surfaced airfield with pan-type hardstandings and a watch office for bomber satellite stations, opened in No. 4 Group Bomber Command. When a detachment of No. 77 Squadron from Linton with their Whitley 5s arrived. Their tenure was brief, and on the 5th of October the squadron was moved to Topcliffe and took the detachment at Tholthorpe with it. The decision was then made to develop Tholthorpe into a fully operational bomber airfield. This resulted in the road from Dering's farm to Tholthorpe village being closed. The new airfield featured 3 concrete and tarmac runways, with the main at 2,000 yards and the other 2 at 1,400 yards. A new control tower of the larger watch office for all commands type was built and sited further out onto the flying field. The old perimeter track was abandoned, with the loss of 15 pans, and 15 of the loop or spectacle type were constructed as replacements to bring the total number of dispersals to 36. 2 T2 and 1 B1 hangars were erected. 1 T2 hangar lay a little to the east of the flying field, with the second T2 near the closed road on the northwest. The B1 was sited on the northeast side of the airfield. The bomb stores were located between runway heads 28 and 34 behind Carle House. The technical site was on the south side of the airfield near Moor Lane, with 12 campsites featuring accommodation for 131 RAF officers, 5 WAF officers, 1,370 other ranks, and 228 WAFs. These were mostly dispersed along the road between Tholthorpe and Flawith villages. Tholthorpe reopened in June 1943 and was allocated to No. 6 Royal Canadian Air Force Bomber Group as a substation for No. 62 base Linton-on-Ouse. On the 13th of June, No. 434 Blue Nose Squadron formed at Tholthorpe and was the first RCAF squadron to be equipped with Halifax 5s. It was joined on the 15th of July by No. 431 Iroquois Squadron, which arrived from Bern, transferring in from No. 4 Group, partly re-equipped with Halifax 5s and still retaining some of their old Wellingtons. On the night of the 12th to 13th of August, No. 434 Squadron commenced operations when 10 aircraft were dispatched from Tholthorpe for a raid on Milan as part of a 321 Lancaster and 183 Halifax force. All 10 returned safely. No. 434's first loss occurred on the night of the 17th to 18th of August on a raid to Peenemunde, when Halifax DK-260 was shot down by a night fighter and crashed at Volgast, with the loss of 4 of the 7 crew. EB-258, which was hit by flak over Vesterland, with the loss of 5 of the crew, and EB-276, which was shot down by a night fighter in the area of Demmin. The pilot, Sergeant Johnson, failed to leave the aircraft when it was abandoned and was the only fatality. No. 431's first loss from Tholthorpe occurred on the night of the 3rd to 4th of October on a raid to Castle, when Halifax LK-925 was shot down on the return journey by a night fighter and crashed near Liège in Belgium. 3 of the crew were killed, 4 were taken as prisoners, and 1 managed to evade capture. On the same raid, No. 434 lost Halifax LK-638, which exploded and crashed at Grossenheindorn, with the loss of 3 of the 7 crew aboard. On the 10th of December, No. 431 Squadron moved to RAF Croft, followed the following day by No. 434. While at Tholthorpe, No. 431 Squadron had lost 13 aircraft, and No. 434 had lost 30. The next day, No. 420 Snowy Owl Squadron arrived from Dalton. And 425 Alouette Squadron arrived from Dishforth, both with new Halifax 3s, and commenced a period of working up on their new aircraft. On the 15th to 16th of February 1944, No. 420 Squadron resumed operations by sending 11 Halifaxes to Berlin. Halifax LW-396 was lost in poor visibility when it crashed at base on its fourth attempt to land, with two of the crew killed. 3 nights later, No. 425 Squadron also resumed operations with a mission to Leipzig. In March, amongst other raids, the targets were Stuttgart, Schweinfurt, Augsburg, and Frankfurt. And both squadrons took place in the disastrous Nuremberg raid on the night of the 30th to 31st of the month. 795 aircraft were dispatched, a force which comprised 572 Lancasters, 214 Halifaxes, and 9 Mosquitoes. The first night fighters appeared just before the bombers reached the Belgian border, and a fierce battle in the moonlight raged for the next hour. Nuremberg was a failure. The city was covered by thick cloud, and a fierce crosswind on the final approach to the target caused many of the pathfinders to mark too far to the east, and a 10-mile creep back developed. 82 bombers were lost on the upward route and near the target, with 64 Lancasters and 31 Halifaxes being lost in total. It was the biggest bomber command loss of the war. No. 429 of No. 425 Squadron was shot down in the target area by a night fighter, with the loss of all 7 crew. In April, the Tholthorpe squadrons began attacking pre-invasion targets such as the railway yards at Lille, Villeneuve-Saint-Georges, Ghent, and Noisy-le-Sec. On the 5th to the 6th of June, the Tholthorpe squadrons took part in Operation Overlord, with attacks on radio and radar stations and heavy gun batteries. From then on, attacks were conducted on flying bomb sites and in support of the Battle of Normandy. On the 28th of June 1944, a near disastrous crash occurred at Tholthorpe, the latest citation for which read, an aircraft of 425 Squadron, while attempting to land, crashed into another, which was parked in the dispersal area and fully loaded with bombs. The former aircraft had broken into 3 parts and was burning furiously. Air Commodore Ross was at the airfield to attend the return of aircraft from operations and the interrogation of air crews. Flight Sergeant St. Germain, a bomb aimer, had just returned from an operational sortie, and Corporal Marquette was in charge of the night ground crew, whilst leading air craftsmen Mackenzie and Wolfe were members of the crew of the crash tender. Air Commodore Ross, with the assistance of Corporal Marquette, extricated the pilot, who had sustained severe injuries. At that moment, 10 500-pound bombs in the second aircraft, about 30 yards away, exploded, and this officer and airman were hurled to the ground. When the hail of debris had subsided, cries were heard from the rear turret of the crashed aircraft. Despite further explosions from bombs and petrol tanks which might have occurred, Air Commodore Ross and Corporal Marquette returned to the blazing wreckage and endeavoured in vain to swing the turret to release the rear gunner. Although the port tailplane was blazing furiously, Air Commodore Ross hacked at the perspex with an axe, and then handed the axe through the turret to the rear gunner, who enlarged the aperture. Taking the axe again, the Air Commodore, assisted now by Flight Sergeant St. Germain, as well as Corporal Marquette, finally broke the perspex steel frame supports and extricated the rear gunner. Another 500-pound bomb exploded, which threw the 3 rescuers to the ground. Flight Sergeant St. Germain quickly rose and threw himself upon a victim in order to shield him from flying debris. Air Commodore Ross's arm was practically severed between the wrist and elbow by the second explosion. He calmly walked to the ambulance and an emergency amputation was performed on arrival at Station 6 quarters. Meanwhile, Corporal Marquette had inspected the surroundings and, seeing petrol running down towards two nearby aircraft, directed their removal from the vicinity by tractor. Leading aircraftsmen Mackenzie and Wolfe rendered valuable assistance in trying to bring the fire under control, and they also helped extricate the trapped rear gunner, both being seriously injured by flying debris. Air Commodore Ross showed fine leadership and great heroism in an action resulting in the saving of the lives of the pilot and rear gunner. He was ably assisted by Sergeant St. Germain and Corporal Marquette, who both displayed courage of a high order. Valuable service was also rendered by leading aircraftsmen Mackenzie and Wolfe in circumstances of great danger. For their heroic actions, Air Commodore Arthur Ross was awarded the George Cross. Flight Sergeant Joseph St. Germain and Corporal Maurice Marquette received the George Medal. Leading aircraftsmen Melvin Mackenzie and Robert Wolfe received the British Empire Medal. During September, the squadrons took part in the oil refineries campaign, with over half of the missions being daylight raids under cover of Spitfires and Mustangs. Targets included the Ruhr Valley, Cologne, Essen, Dortmund, Duisburg, Bochum, and Wilhelmshaven. Homburg, Oberhausen, Hagen, Kastrop, Ruxell, Varna, Eichel, and the industrial centre of Gelsenkirchen were also attacked at this time. On the night of the 2nd to 3rd of November, both the Tholthorpe squadrons were part of the 561 Lancasters, 400 Halifaxes, and 31 Mosquitoes force that attacked Dusseldorf. This was to be the last major bombing raid of the war. There were no losses for either number 420 or 425 squadrons, but a total of 11 Halifaxes and 8 Lancasters failed to return. The last operational mission for number 420 squadron was on the 22nd of April 1945, when 17 Halifaxes were dispatched to bomb Bremen, but on arriving over the target, the master bomber ordered them not to bomb. All aircraft returned to Tholthorpe. 3 days later, on the 25th, was the last operational mission of No. 425 Squadron, when 18 Halifaxes were dispatched to bomb gun positions on Vangarooga Island, and again, all aircraft returned to base. After hostilities in Europe had ceased, both units were selected as part of Tiger Force for duties in the Pacific and converted to the Canadian-built Lancaster B Mark 10s. On the 12th of June 1945, No. 420 Squadron flew their Lancasters to Debert, Nova Scotia for reorganisation and training, and were followed the following day by No. 425 Squadron. No. 420 Squadron's awards were 38 DFCs, 1 barr to a DFC, and 9 DFMs. They lost 65 aircraft and 324 aircrew, of whom 84 were killed or presumed dead, 228 were missing, 6 were prisoners of war, 4 were injured, and 2 were proved safe. Non-operational losses were 3 aircraft, 12 personnel killed and 6 injured, of whom 1 later died. No. 425 Squadron's awards were 2 MBEs, 163 DFCs, 4 barrs to DFCs, 2 George Medals, 18 DFMs, 1 American DFC, and 4 mentions in dispatches. They lost 55 aircraft, 338 aircrew, of whom 190 were either killed or presumed dead. Of the survivors who failed to return from operations, 91 were taken prisoners of war, with one escaping. 7 were interned, 54 evaded captured or proved safe, and 4 were listed under fate unknown. Non-operational losses were 11 aircraft and 73 personnel, of whom 64 were killed, 8 were injured, and 1 died of natural causes. RAF Tholthorpe was closed after the departure of the Canadians and was not retained by the post-war RAF. In the 1950s, most of the facilities were dismantled. Much of the concrete was dug up from the runways, and the minor road running almost north-south across the site was reopened. A few buildings remain, but are derelict and many overgrown with bushes and trees. The southeast corner is used by a poultry firm, and the former technical area is used for light industry, although a few structures remain there. A blister hangar, the gas mask and dinghy stores, the parachute store, a bombing trailer, 4 Romney huts, and the MT section survive in this area. There is also one T2 hangar surviving. The 1943 control tower has been turned into a family residence, while the 1941 lies derelict and crumbling. A monument of Canadian granite on the village green, and an avenue of oaks and maples between the village and the airfield, was placed to honour the former airmen who served in the Royal Canadian Air Force squadrons based at Tholthorpe.